1951, I came here. I was born in Tanzania, Dar es Salaam, in 1936. My great-grandparents were from India. He was a businessman, a very big businessman. So he was doing business. So my father and all came to Africa. My father was just a clerk, and my mother was a Quran teacher. She was teaching in madrasa and also at home in Tanzania. She was a zakira. She was reciting majalis in month of Muharram and Safar in the mosque. In this society, England was a middle class. African was very low class on those days, and the British was very high level. And I was going to school in Indian schools. Yeah. And I was very keen to learn and to study. But according to on those days, the girls were not allowing to study more, further studies. You know, only 8th grade or 4th education. 8th grade, yeah. But then I was very keen, and I was helping at home my mom with the Quran. I was married in Zanzibar. We stayed there about 20 years. My husband was an editor of Samachar paper. He was running a big press, printing press, and was also publishing the paper Samachar. And also I was working there. I was printing there, yeah, in the machine on those days, yeah. In my family, the ladies were not going to the shop. So I was the first one to go to the printing press with him. And when he goes out, I was looking after the printing press. But I don't know, on those days I was very smart. Not now. Like I'm very, very nervous nowadays. In Zanzibar, people were not, they were all the time, they were at home, ladies. And I was going down because the press was downstairs. The house was up, so it was very easy to go and come back. And was sitting in the chair of
the boss.
And taking the telephone and everything, yeah. And I became more close to the African people because we have got a very big field, shamba, in Zanzibar. So we had some cows, all these things, you know. So clothes, it is a famous, Zanzibar is a famous for clothes and coconuts. So I used to go with my husband for the work, and all the African people were working, and also I became more closer to these people. I was helping them working, and this way I was very familiar with them, yeah, in Zanzibar, yeah. And the Zanzibarian people are very religious, very religious, because mostly they were Muslims over there. 85% they were Muslim. And I must say they are very, very pious. My 4 children were born in Zanzibar. Fatima, first daughter, she's in London. Second one is Musaddiq. Third is Fahmida, girl. Fourth is Arif. And the last, fifth is Murtaza. It was a revelation on those days in Zanzibar. The government of Zanzibar, they confiscated the whole press. Our old property, they were confiscated. the whole, the house and the furniture, everything. Was confiscated. Yeah, we lost everything. So we went to Dar es Salaam. My husband, when everything was confiscated, he was not the elder, but he has taken the whole of, responsibility of the family, you know, my brother-in-laws and everybody, the whole family. So he was really worrying everything, very distressed then, when the when these people confiscated the whole things. We came here in UK, in London, for operation. It was a heart problem. He has got a heart problem. So they operated here and he passed away. Because I was the youngest one, he was only 6 years old on those days. And after that, 12 years was Arif, number four, and then two years old children. Yeah, that is, yeah. And one daughter was married. She was only 18 when she was married, yeah. Two sons were here, and my second daughter also is married here in UK. I and Murtaza only, we were at, in Dar es Salaam. And then I decided to come here to join with my family. Musaddiq called us, me and Murtaza, so we came here. First, when we came, we went to London. He was living in London. I was, I think, 44 years old. I was thinking, can I stay here with all these people and with all this type of life? I was shocked first. I was thinking, how can I stay? How can I mix with this type of people? They were talking so, sometimes it just doesn't say, obviously, or what, I don't know what to say. But gradually then I cope with these people, and alhamdulillah, gradually I came to mix with them. Because my husband was an editor of Samachar paper, so whenever he goes out, he goes with the meetings and all the invited, he was all the invitation, he was going and he was taking me with him, no? Mm-hmm. So I was going and I was talking with the people. But when my husband died, I was very depressed and I forgot everything then. For a few years, I had a very bad time and I lost the confidence. I started again Quran teaching because I was teaching in Dar es Salaam. In 1976, I started in Dar es Salaam.
La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah.
First, we started in 1985. In the mosque. We didn't have chairs. We were just on benches only. And then we went to St. Paul's Hall. It was a hall. From there we went to St. Joseph's College. After that year, in 1997, we had our building, this building, Sayyidah building. The Jamaat has built it. and then removed here. But I found it very difficult to explain the children. So I thought better to find out some easy method to explain these children. Gradually I started to write this book, and alhamdulillah it. First I was doing worksheets, starting because how it goes, you know. But alhamdulillah it went very successfully. Till now they are easy, alhamdulillah. Allah's help. All this method came, I myself don't also understand how it came, you know. Sometimes I'm wondering, is it my idea? I don't know how it came.
This Mai is?
No.
Yes, I've been talking about her.
No,
everyone knows her. What's her name? Rumi Auntie? This is Rubab Master, okay? He has been doing these books for us, and we're going to use them for years and years to come, okay? So we should be really thankful to her for simplifying these books for us. Yes, and pray for her for a long, healthy life, inshallah.
You can help me to read that. This is a hard one. Go on, Simon.
Yeah.
Ka, excellent. Well done, that was really good. How about this one? Hey there, Ali. Hello. Say that again for me.
Ka.
And what do we have to do?
Books are in the pictures also. I've done some pictures in it. So the people were not accepting it. When I was doing some seminar in teaching Quran, I found it very difficult. The people were objecting it. What type of this method? We haven't heard this method. And all the teachers are very well trained and they are very supporting. So alhamdulillah, they have picked this method and they are teaching the same method. When I see, I think as I am teaching now, but more than me. They become more clever than me.
Allah, the Quran, our religion is Islam. Five noble pillars upholding what is virtuous. To make the testimony is the base of the faith, and the fast and the prayer, the pilgrimage and charity. To make the testimony is the base of the faith, and the fast and the prayer, the pilgrimage and charity.
These are books on Ziyarat al-Ashura, and this book was made by Rubi Auntie. It was always her wish that young children in Madrasa should be able to recite Ziyarat al-Ashura, and she made these accessible by getting the books printed in large, clear writing for the children to be able to read.
As-salamu alayka ya ibn amir al-mu'minin wa ibn sayyid al-wasiyyin. As-salamu alayka ya ibn fatimah al-zahra.
And what happened? I went to Iran. I went to Iran and I went to Imam Khomeini's mazar. I went there, yeah. So I went there and I saw children. They reciting Ziyarat al-Ashura. The school children came for to visit, and they were sitting there, and they were reciting Ziyarat al-Ashura. So I thought, what are they doing? So I saw they got the one page of Ziyarat al-Ashura, very little handwriting, and they were reciting. I said, wow, how nice. What about my children in Birmingham? Then I went to India and gave this Hadati Ashura, but it is written by hand from somebody, so that the children can read the handwriting, because the small handwriting in Wafati, our children couldn't read it. So alhamdulillah, when it came here and we started to teach, nowadays the same dream came true. Now 11 year you saw, the 11 year children now can recite Sadati Ashura. When I published this book, so they offered me to come and teach in Madrasa this method. First I went to Paris, they called me about Madrasa and this Quran. So I went there first time, yeah, alone. And then after that I went to Portugal. Even that was month of Ramadan. I stayed there for 15 days, and it was Quran and Majalis, and speeches only about Quran. And then I went to Switzerland, they called me. But Switzerland, only 9 days I stayed. But we were traveling every part of the Switzerland, you know, different cities, yeah. All was about Quran. And then I went to New York. Also, that was also month of Ramadan, and it was Quran, regarding Quran, and lectures of Quran, and some speeches. Then I went to Sweden. Sweden also in month of Ramadan, I was teaching this Quran method. So 11, 12 days I stayed there. And also I went to Canada, and there also I was teaching Quran, all this method. I don't know how did I invite. The letter came and we were discussing what to do in month of Ramadan, to go, how to go, and Murtaza encouraged me, because he invited also, you can come, anybody can come with you. So Murtaza was ready to come. He left his job and came with me for 11 days in Iran. And I came, I was only one woman from the whole group. not from Europe, the whole, I got the whole invitees. And I was the only one woman. All were men. The president told me, what type of book is this? So many pictures. This is Quran book. Why you written this, all this? Why you drawn this, all the pictures and this and that? Oh my God, I couldn't answer him. I was so shocked. But you know, Imam Ali is saying, I remember, Imam Ali says, teach your children according to Zamana, according to the time. So I say, this is wonderful, excellent. That was my answer. This people likes Mashad, some Islam, but I like Qum. I don't know, I feel so peaceful over there. I meet Ayatollah Bajat. I prayed behind him, yeah, in his mosque. I found the prayer was very spiritual. And then when I met Ayatollah Amin and Ayatollah Sistani in Iraq, whenever I go, I must go and meet him.
From this A, B, C, and D, Farida. This Inna Allaha Sami'un Alim. Surely Allah is hearing, knowing.
Yes.
Me.
Surely Allah is hearing.
Is it right? Everybody
agrees? Yes. I think these sentences sometimes are so tricky.
Yeah.
Not really.
Yeah.
It says,
find the meaning of the following words.
My mother-in-law, she was quite old, and you know, in that generation, the Quran was not that proper. So we went to Rubianti as well, and she taught us in Africa, the different parts of Africa, from where we come from, Uganda, they didn't have many Maharij. You know, we couldn't pronounce the Maharij letters mm-hmm. properly. So me and my mother-in-law, we sat with her, and she was giving us some tuitions as well to learn how to pray proper recitation. And Alhamdulillah, she did a lot for my girls as well. You know, they used to go to her house to recite Dua Tawassul, and I don't know, maybe she's forgotten, but we all remember her. And she did Dua Ahad with my daughter Zainab, and she did quite a few, you know, duas with them. So we really, really appreciate what she's done for us.
Well, we were taught to read the Quran, but Tajweed was never explained. We have not learnt the higher Tajweed. We recited Idgham because that is the way to recite it,
but
not why, what, or how. So the books that were published, and I can say this as a student of Rubianti myself, and for my children who are now the students of Madrasa, that it helped to understand Tajweed mm-hmm. in the most simplest of ways.
I wrote my favorites here. I use mostly all of this. This is our Jamaat. This is London Jamaat. This is Quran recitation and translation online. Karbala Live. This is also Umi. She is one of our London. She is living in London. She's a teacher, Quran teacher. And also I listen her lecture sometime to refer. Yeah. And the Mukhtar literature. It's my favorite. Because when I miss some, I can get from the computer, from the internet.
اگر همه وارد میدان شدید و هر یک از شما یک محل از کوفه را بران کنید و نگذارید بیز به شما جنبنده ای در کوچه ها و میادین حرکت کند مطمئن
But it had a big impact and I think that brought the whole transformation I mean in the community not him only But there were many. Then the start of the revolution was slowly spreading. And hijab became... Today I can clearly say that hijab in England all over the world it is because of Iran. That people are proud or at least they do not have that, you know, hindrance or inhibition. Mm. That is what I tell that friend of mine, you know, who is in Iran. The blood is not lost in vain. You should understand the sacrifice of those people is the result we are getting today. Although you cannot appreciate it, you get used to that, you know.
Iranians, I don't think appreciate what they've done themselves. If they knew, you know, what seismic shifts, what earthquake they have caused in other places, they think they, you know, that their achievements are not that. The achievements that Iran have, the, you know, it's something to be proud of.
In my family, they were criticizing, you know, all this. This is not Islam and this and that, you know. But afterward, alhamdulillah, everybody came to realize what they were saying. Now they are changing their words. In those days, nobody was ready to wear hijab. But nowadays, young children, before 9, even if you go to the mosque, you will see 4-year girls, they are wearing hijab. Yeah. And in the school, they are wearing, but alhamdulillah, there are so many, in the mostly people are wearing hijab. It's special. They are proud of it. Even in university, they are very proud of it because my granddaughter is in university. She is doing her pharmacy. She is wearing, she's really fulfilling her hijab, very strictly, yeah. And all her friends, 4 of her friends, they are wearing hijab. They are in one house living together. It is 100 years ago. I found it in treasure book in Zanzibar. I got this book from Umma. very difficult on that time to carry all this heavy, heavy book with you. But Alhamdulillah, I brought it till here. From Dar es Salaam, Zanzibar to Dar es Salaam, and Dar es Salaam to UK. And I am with this book. This is first part, so it says 1 to 10 part. And this is 11 to 20. And this from 21 to 30 part of the Quran. Before I was reading Quran, but I didn't understand what it says. Then I found it very interesting as I came to know, and then I started to teach. And when I get any difficulty, I just open it, and I really get it the same thing what I wanted. This is the miracle of this book. It makes me busy, and also it gives me very peace in my mind. Quran is a peace thing for me. When I feel a little bit not normal, I just take my Quran with tafsir and everything. So I get everything in this world. This Quran is everything for me. Whenever I feel a little bit down, low, because I take my Quran and I really feel very good. And I'm living on this holy book.